Excuse me. So we're moving on to the dining and sharing of stories phase of the evening. Obviously, this isn't really amplified, but as we, and I wish we had duct tape. That's the Brewers patron saint duct tape, but we've taped our recorder up here. And as we come up and share the stories in the first part of the night, I just ask so that we know who's saying what. Just say your name before you get up and share a story so that we can record this. As we said at today's meeting earlier, some of the folks from staff weren't there. In our recent board meetings, we've recognized how lucky we are to be an industry that's only 30 or so years young, is so vibrant and growing, but that our pioneers are still so active in our industry, and that we have a great opportunity to record really the beginnings and the evolution of our industry verbatim from the folks that started it. And I was on a little bit low, but I did a mix, iPod mix of one artist from every decade of the craft brewing renaissance, starting with Joni Mitchell in the 70s and Talking Heads in the 80s and so forth. But you know, when you think of the 70s and our and the beginning of our of this renaissance, and I think of Charlie teaching a course on home brewing, you know, from a mimeographed you know, series of papers that ended up being evolving into the joy of home brewing, and how many of the people at this room and our members started with that to get into this career. I think of the 70s as Fritz Maytag and Anchor, or Jack and New Albion, or Ken going to invite potential investors to Anchor and not even asking if he could take a tour, but just moving people that work out of the way and giving.
Mom.
It was your mom. Okay. All right. Good. All right. But it is pretty amazing that the folks that were there to start this are here as well. So you know, if you guys are feeling the moment, want to come up and share a moment in the evolution of this renaissance, particularly as it pertains to our group, the Brewers Association, the earlier DNA of the Brewers Association, the AOB, BAA, whatever it is that was moments in our path, that'd be wonderful. And I'm looking forward to hearing some stories. Cheers.
Well, I will
come up.
And I may come up later after I've had a couple more beers.
This is Ken Grossman.
Thanks. After I've had a few more beers, I may tell more stories, but I'll at least kick things off. So I was invited to join the BAA by Fritz Maytag, and I think it was 82. It could have been 83, but it was somewhere very early on in our existence. And I was contacted by Bill O'Shea, and some of you, most of you, I'm sure have never heard of Bill O'Shea or met Bill O'Shea, but he was the founder of the original BAA. The BAA was founded during World War II to help small brewers get tin for bottle caps. Small brewers were not able to buy bottle caps. They couldn't bottle their beer. And so the original BAA came together in Chicago. I wasn't around in that day, but I was asked to come join the BAA when Fritz was involved. And I went to my first convention, I think it was 83 or 84, in Fort Lauderdale, Florida, at the Pier 61 Hotel. 66, excuse me, Pier 66 Hotel. I had a couple more beers, I'd remember my stories better, but Pier 66 Hotel. And back then, actually, in the charter of the original BAA, it said the convention will be held this weekend at the Pier 66 Hotel every year. And Bill O'Shea loved that hotel. They were the first customers to book the hotel. He got some kind of a special deal. It was the top floor of the hotel had a rotating bar. I think he liked that. And they went from Chicago to Pier 66, and it was there for 40 years or something until the hotel started to fell apart. But every year we have this conference there. And I remember going my first time. I was, you know, the smallest brewer by far. I mean, Fritz at that point had some stature. I had no stature. And I showed up, and it was like, here's all these brewers, and I'm a home brewer in spirit and in mind. And we were making, you know, maybe 5,000 barrels or 3,000 barrels or something. And Bill O'Shea, who was the CEO, president of the association, sort of chuckled at us. Actually, there were stories that he made a lot of money buying Anheuser-Busch stock. And here he represented the small brewers. That was his livelihood, but he made his money on the side investing in Anheuser-Busch. So there were, I think, a split as far as where his focus was. But he kept the small brewers together. The conventions back then were pretty different. My wife used to go with me. There were lots of people in suits and ties, and there'd be a formal banquet every night, and we'd say the Pledge of Allegiance, and we would sing Auld Lang Syne. We'd sing songs, actually. The whole group of brewers at the end of the evening, and the following banquet lunch was like 10 songs, and everybody would know the words, and I was like, Jesus, this is not my group at all. But I remember Ted Marty gave a talk one of my first or second convention years I went, and he talked about his companies. I think it was 125th maybe back then. I can't remember what year. They were celebrating their anniversary. And he gave a talk, and it was, you know, family business. It was Ted Marty, August Shells. Yeah, it was very cool. But I remember presentations on, you know, brewers talking about how, you know, they used to discharge all their wastewater right into the river, and they were forced to put in a wastewater treatment plant, and that was their big deal. They talk about how that they could no longer send all their wastewater into the river right next to the brewery, and it was a big project for them. And other people saying, well, you know, as a kid, I swam in that river, and there were huge catfish, and we would, you know, right where the brewery water went, brewery wastewater went right in the river, there'd be, you know, fish this big living right there. How great it was. But it was different times, and the organization back then had a lot of malt suppliers, a lot of hop dealers, and a handful of brewers. And I remember my first year being, you know, very wide-eyed. You know, this is, you know, who I've tried to come into this industry, and I'm just a nobody. And Fritz pretty quickly got a lot of acclaim because he was, you know, the only one who was growing. Back in those days, all the small brewers were shrinking and going out of business. And I remember after my second or third convention, I came back feeling very depressed because, you know, during the evening you talk about, oh, this brewer just closed last year, and these guys aren't making it. They're going to probably be closed next month. And so it was a fairly dismal time for the brewing industry with, you know, sort of the survivors club. Every year it was, you know, very negative. There wasn't a lot of excitement other than Fritz, who sort of brought some energy. So he pretty quickly became president, I think probably in 85 or 86 or 87 or something. He became president of the Brewers Association because he was sort of the visionary for the future, and there was some light, you know, some hope that the organization was going to survive and grow. I remember Bill O'Shea being, he had come from a different area. He had been an attorney, but had spent his whole life sort of running the association. And as he was getting older and a bit more frail, and the you know, basically all the small brewers were going out of business. At one point, and FX Matt was president at that point, and FX was a very, you know, impressive leader for the association. It was, you know, he had a, much like Nick, he had a really great way to deal with keeping the group together and to try to move things forward. And I remember Bill O'Shea was ill, and he said, well, we're not going to have a convention this year, and we're going to close down the association. We're done. And FX was, I don't think so. You know, we're going to go on. We're going to, you know, find a new chairman, a new president. We're going to keep this association going. And there was a few months of a lot of stress. I mean, it was, how do we, you know, sort of transition from the Bill O'Shea era onto the future? And FX pioneered that and worked and really, you know, got the group back together. And we had a convention the next year. And sort of things moved on from then. So it was, you know, very, very interesting times for my career because I was, you know, the smallest guy, and you know, sort of struggling to find my way. And here the association was in the same place, and we saw the light at the end of the tunnel, and the association continued to grow and here we are today with a wonderful, healthy industry, and a lot of it has to do with people like FX and Fritz and those early pioneers who saw that there was a future for the industry. So that's all I'm going to say right now, but I'll come back up later if I want some more beers.
You said a lot of things that brought back a lot of memories for me, Ken. This is Sam Calagione here speaking. No. So whatever I say, blame it on him. you said one thing you said is that there's a lot of suits and ties and jackets. And back in those days, like all through the 80s, I went to the Master Brewers meetings and the ASBC meetings and the BAA meetings. My first one was 1982, which I'll tell you about. I mean, everybody wore suits and ties and jackets and ties. And I think when we started having our conventions, people were just like kind of thought we were being pretty disrespectful as brewers not to be in a tie and a jacket and being formal. But boy, the industry has changed a hell of a lot since then. We got people even wearing sandals to conferences, even in the winter. But not today. But I remember my first BAA conference was 1982, and it was a result of a guy named Tom Burns, who was the brewer at the Cartwright Brewing in Oregon. And he came to Boulder in 1981, and I met him for the first time when we had our home brewers conference at the famous Chautauqua conference up on here in Boulder. And first time I met Fred Eckhart, he came. Michael Jackson, that was the first time he came. And the first time we had a panel of microbrewers, it was Tom Burns and a couple of people from the Boulder Brewing that were on stage talking about how do you start a small brewery. And but Tom was involved, and he eventually moved to Boulder and became the second brewmaster of Boulder Beer out at the Goat Shed, and then eventually moved to Michigan. But he was instrumental in helping the Great American Beer Festival get off the ground, because he, as a brewer, he was a young brewer. He had long hair and a ponytail, and he had gone to the BAA conference, and people really took a liking to him. For whatever reason, he was very social kind of guy, and people just really like what his personality. And we were lucky to have him in Boulder, and he was on the originally helping us with the Great American Beer Festival, and it was through his connections with the BAA, and he was doing the asking for the beers, basically, on behalf of the American Home Brewers Association. I mean, if you can imagine, there's a group of home brewers that call themselves the AHA, we were only 3 years old then, that want you to send us 10 cases of beer so we can throw a party. A beer called the Great American Beer Festival. And they all did. On the merit of Tom Burns and his relationships, and we had the festival in June of 1982, and in the fall of 82, he encouraged me to go to the BAA, and I remember my first BAA meeting. The only beer I really went for was the Anchor Steam and the Porter, and that was all that I enjoyed. I tried the other stuff too, but it definitely, I related to what Ken was saying, and I was like. Standing with my back against the wall, hoping that I wouldn't get, you could just tell the vibes in the room was, who the heck is this guy representing, homebrewers and Mike's. They didn't even have the word micro. I don't think we had the word microbrewers yet even. It was just very weird and very uncomfortable. And I remember Fritz telling me he felt the same way when he went to the BAA, and you obviously did too. It's very weird. But because you were in the room with all these legendary founders or family owners of these breweries that are now history, most of them are all history. But I went to those conferences just like Ken did for about 10 years running at the Pier 66, and then we went to New Orleans and maybe another place in Florida for a year or two before it kind of happened. Yeah, I remember that one, and Henry King was there. Yes, I remember that one. I remember the rotating bar, and I remember the hot tub. I remember Brewer's Digest, and Ron Siebel and Roger Brees were Tori Whitney. What did I say? Yeah, and I'd say Roger Brees and Ron Siebel were extremely instrumental in getting the AHA and what we were championing in those days plugged into the professional brewers community, because they came to our conference probably in 19. They came in 1980 and 81 and 82. They brought professors, the lead people from Weihenstephan and Domans, and to come and speak at our conferences in those days. And they were just so supportive. And I say the two of the most influential people in those early days that were connected to the brewing community, beside Tom Burns, who was a microbrewer, but was Ron Siebel and Roger Brees. I mean, they kind of saw that we were on to something. We didn't know what we were on to, but they did, and they were kind of talking us up and said, "You ought to invite these guys over to talk to you about beer." Which was, talking about beer was very unique in those days, because they didn't talk about beer in terms of what we talk today. It was very strange, but those are some of my thoughts that were inspired by Ken's little thing. There's more. I'll have another beer.
Any questions?
I am, because I think chronologically. I was thinking about it sitting there chronologically. I maybe sort of fit next. I went to my first BAA conference in 1996 in Boston. Harpoon, you know, they did the dinner. And I have to say that I went and I thought, I found my tribe. These are people who are like me, and they're, at that point, I mean, we were certainly not big, but we were a production brewery, not just a brew pub, and we were never a brew pub. So it was people who were also production breweries. Michael Laybourne was the president of the BAA at the time, or the chair of the board. FX was on the board. Ken was on the board. Irene Fermat, Irene Fermat, Full Sail. Michael Laybourne was Mendocino. Ken, of course. Fred Bowman with Portland. Who else was on the board then, Ken? Anyway, so we had this event in Boston, and I had been asked to be on the board, which is why I was there. And just a little side story, Harpoon had the entertainment for the evening, and they served seafood, and Alan Newman had a mouthful of oysters with cocktail sauce, and Fred Bowman was standing right across from him in a like sort of butter yellow cashmere V-neck sweater, and Alan sneezed and like sneezed all of these things all over Fred. And if you know Fred, Fred's kind of a particular guy, and he was horrified by Alan, who, if you know Alan, of course thought that was, you know, horribly funny. So, and I was standing there like, oh my God. And Gary, you were there. We commandeered the hotel bar until like 4 in the morning, drinking really port. We drank them out of all the port that they had, until finally the staff came along and said, we need to go home. Could you guys please, we don't have any more port. We're done. Larry Bell called me at 4 in the morning to talk about a coup of the, I could never figure out whether it was a coup of the BAA or a coup of the AOB. But anyway, so that's my BAA story. And then I was invited shortly thereafter to be on the board of the AOB. So I was the only board member on both in both organizations. And
how three acronyms you served up?
I've served on all three acronyms. That's right. And that, I think, was because primarily because I lived in, you know, this area so I could get to the AOB meetings. And I said, yes, I would do that, but on one condition, that everyone knew, because we'd already started having conversations, that everyone knew that in my mind, my goal was to bring the two trade associations together, and that I was going to kind of serve as a liaison between the two. And I tell you these stories not to complain, but because I think they're good for the historical record. My first meeting, all of the board members decided that they were going to go out to dinner, but they didn't invite me. So, like, I drove home alone, like, okay, so, you know, maybe they're a little nervous about, you know, my stance on all of this stuff. My second board meeting, they asked me to go home partway through the meeting. Said, I'm sorry, you need to leave now. So I was like, okay, I'm really a hit with these people. They're liking me a lot. Two meetings down, it's like I'm going to one more, and, you know, we'll see what happens. But if by the third meeting, if they're, like, spitting on me by the third meeting, something's got to change here. So, but then the process of that transition between the two groups happened. And the part that I think is, you know, today in our board meeting, we, of course, as we always do, we look at the financials and we have the operations report. And when we started the process, what did we call that? There was a group. Nick, you were in that group. There was a name that we had in that first year that was like, suspend your judgment and just keep trying, was essentially the gist of the thing. And I facilitated that for 2 years. And there were a lot of people who did not want to have the AHA connected to what would be this new entity. And they did not want to have Brewers publications connected to this new entity, to say nothing of things like, you know, making sure that we were also doing our export development work. And really, Jack Joyce, in some meeting along the way, said to me and a couple of other people, are you crazy? There are people who would kill to have their consumers so tightly tied to their organization. And so, you know, in this 2-year process, I kept saying to people, well, you know, I know that you don't really want the AHA and Brewers publications, but let's just suspend that for now, and we'll see how it goes. And if they turn out to be like a problem, we'll cut them loose later. But we don't really know what we have here. We just really haven't spent enough time with this to figure it out. But it was, I think Nick would say, it was a huge sticking point in that first year. I mean, the name of the organization was nothing compared to, you know, are these two bits of what was then the AOB. Actually, it wasn't, because the AOB was just the professional brewers part, but the whole entity, are these two bits going to be able to go on with us? And the reason I tell you that story is because all of us sitting here now know that you guys have killed it on those two entities, on those three entities, including export development. And one of the things that I think is a hallmark of craft brewers generally is that suspension of doubt. And we didn't say we can't do that. We said, let's just suspend that for a while and let's see what happens. And for 30 plus years, we've been saying, as a community of really interesting and fun people, let's just suspend that doubt and let's see what happens. And so to all of the men that I have worked with for all of these years, because really there's been an occasional woman or two, but they hightail it and leave the building in no time. It has been my absolute pleasure to suspend those moments of doubt and just see what happens, because what's happened is pretty magical. And so, you know, here's to magic and to everyone who said, I know we can do this, and thank you.
Thank you.
I'm going to say your name, and I'm going to say, no, I can do it.
That was Kim Jordan. I'm also going to take a quick moment, and obviously we're in a beautiful setting, and some of the things Kim said, as the things Ken said, sparked something for Charlie. Some of the things Kim said sparked something for me. And the thing that it sparked for me was I remember on events committee maybe 5 or 6 or 7 years ago, we started discussing the idea of a pro-am category and bringing that into the GABF world. And the discussion at the committee level was wonderfully heated, and everybody was saying their opinions. And at the end of that discussion, something that came up in that discussion was this would never happen in the wine world, where the hobbyist community of winemakers would actually be allowed in with the venerated community of internationally recognized professional winemakers. This is awkward, you know, those lines. And there was a pause in the conversation, and somebody said, yeah, but that is what's great about our community, is that line almost doesn't exist, because so many of us moved between those lines to make this community grow. And there's a Sam Shepard play where he gets busted cheating on his woman, and he says, oh, it's the same love, honey. It just got split in two. And I think of my homebrewer side of my heart and my professional brewer side of the heart as the same love that just got split in two. And while I do have the mic, I do want to recognize and thank our host tonight early on. I'm hoping that Ray, who runs the joint, will get up and talk a little about the pairings, because as you can see, a lot went into this. But we've got Mariah, Autumn, Max, and Ray, and the kitchen of staff doing what they're doing.
Kim's talking reminded a bunch of things for me, so I thought I would follow her. And to just give you a little personal history, I joined our brewery in 1989, and so I do not go back. Our brewery is 125 years old, and so we're actually kind of different than most everybody else in the room. I'm not personally 125 years old. The brewery is. I joined in 1989, and actually joined... I was in another career at the time, and I actually joined because the brewery was going to be sold. And it was causing a pretty large family fight, and so I had not intended to work for Procter & Gamble, and that's where I was. And I was president of a division and doing fine, but that's not what I intended to do, and so I decided to go back, and I told my wife we'd go for a couple of years, I'd get it figured out, and then we'd move away. Well, that was 22 years later, as we're still there. She reminds me that often. But in any case, and I tell you that partly because let me set the stage a little bit. Today, it's so different. You know, all of those brewers that were at those BAA conferences faced a different world that we don't face today, and we're very lucky because basically everybody was making the same kind of beer. It was all pretty mainstream beer, pretty light Pilsner beers or light beer. And now the question was, were you advertising on television and probably charging a higher price and making a good profit like Budweiser, Miller, and Coors were? Or were you at rock-bottom prices like Old Milwaukee, Mill Best, etc.? When I joined our brewery, basically those people were selling beer at prices that we couldn't make the beer for. That puts you in a pretty difficult competitive situation. And as a result of that, a lot of people were going out of business. And it was, the BAA was a very difficult environment because the old line that was still there was basically disappearing. And, you know, today, we are one of a handful of breweries, historic regional breweries in the United States. To go back to the founding of what happened here, though, the BAA was, I remember I was on the board at that time, and I guess my brother FX had gotten off. But in any case, Chuck Lawson, there we had this transition committee that was studying this thing, and Chuck Lawson was on it, and he said, I don't want to be on it anymore. In any case, Chuck said, I don't want to be on it anymore, and I got nominated to be on it for whatever reason. And so I was on this transition committee that was going to study this, and I do remember coming out and meeting out here in the Boulderado, we met in the Oxford down in Denver, and had discussions, and it was very interesting, because the concept of putting these two organizations together was a great concept, but they were very different organizations. I mean, it was day and night. The AOB was probably the day, as much as most of us wouldn't have wanted to admit it, and the BAA, was the night, because they were going to go away. And putting these two together was a real challenge, and there were a lot of discussions. I remember writing out various strategies and stuff that were involved with what the mission of this new organization would be, etc. And to the point that Kim makes about the home brewers and brewers publications, you had business people quote on this, and these two ends of this new organization were not making any money. In fact, they were losing money. And this organization wasn't exactly well-funded to begin with. Neither of them was well funded to begin with. So the real question was whether these two things were going to drag down the whole thing, and I think that was the real question involved. And maybe we didn't have the vision to see what the home brewers would add to it, and or what Brewers Publication. But it was probably more, at least as I remember it, a financial perspective. I was on the board, the initial board, and I was involved for the first couple of years, and then I left for two or three years. And I will tell you that my memory in coming back, probably the thing that surprised me the most in coming back to be on the board, was what shape this BA had financially had gotten itself into. It was unbelievable. When I left the board, we were still kind of just inching forward. We weren't losing money, but we sure weren't making an awful lot of money. And all of a sudden, you come back, and these events are making all sorts of money, and Brewers Publication is positive. And the American Home Brewers, not only aren't they losing money, they're making money. I said, this is unbelievable. What the hell has happened in these few years? Anyway, and really, it was obviously the board had set a good direction, but I would credit Charlie and Bob and all the staff for once they understood what they were supposed to do, they put their head down, they made it happen, and to this day, I think that is a hallmark of this organization. You guys do a fantastic job once the direction is set of getting it done and doing an outstanding job, and I think that is why this organization has been so successful. So congratulations to all of you.
All right, I'm Gary Fish, Deschutes Brewery, Bend, Oregon, small town. I want to go a little bit of a different direction, because I have stories about the BAA and the AOB and all that kind of stuff too, but I'm probably the only one here who's not actually a brewer and never has been. I didn't homebrew. I mean, I have homebrewed, but not with any level of confidence that would gain me any notoriety at all. But, I started as a restaurant guy opening a brew pub in a small town in Central Oregon to try and kind of strike out on our own and simplify our lives a little bit. And I was very lucky that the original brewer I hired was John Harris, who most of you probably know, but John is a wonderful guy, one of the most talented pure brewers I've ever met, and a, you know, he was able to kind of introduce me to more people than I needed maybe or wanted to know, but it led me here, so I guess it's all good. You know, some of the early days I remember, and I think of the early days of GABF, and I never got to experience, because I was working, the flood at the Hilton during GABF and other memorable events like that. But my first memories of GABF were at the Merchandise Mart. And I remember meeting, the first time I met, for instance, Jeff and Marcy Larson, Alaskan Brewery, was in their room in the Merchandise Mart with a pony keg of smoked porter in the bathtub and a platter of smoked salmon on the dresser. And I didn't know who these people were, but I liked them immediately. The evenings after the event were usually filled with the anchor guys' infamous old foghorn party in the room, where they'd open a pony keg of old foghorn barley wine in their room after the GABF got over. And that's where I met Bob Brewer and Bruce Joseph and Mark Carpenter and those guys, in a room that is smaller than the rooms we have, way smaller than the rooms we have at the Julian, a very nice hotel, but nonetheless had 150 people standing on the beds because there was nowhere else to stand. The balcony was about 8 inches wide, but that was enough to get the pony keg out of the room and out on the balcony. And there were days like that. I still remember the first BAA meeting I had ever attended, which was the same one Kim talked about in Boston. Irene Fermat had convinced me to join and go to the meeting. And Larry Bell, who I had met at a few of those GABF old foghorn parties, tried to recruit me immediately. First BAA meeting I had ever been to. He tried to recruit me in some form of palace coup he was planning. He had the whole, you know, talk about Robert's Rules of Orders. He had this whole thing figured out, how he was going to take back the BAA from whatever demon had possessed it. And I still don't really understand all that he explained to me, but what I do remember is he had it all planned, where everybody was going to stand up at one time, and he was going to call some constitutional convention, and Gary Nateman, who was the attorney for the BAA at the time, you know, Larry stood up, nobody else stood up with him, hollered something at poor Michael Laybourne, who was, I think to this day, still trying to figure out what happened, and Gary got up and basically, in his lawyer-esque way, you know, told Larry to sit down and shut up, which Larry did, and the rest of the meeting went smoothly. A couple other things, you know, Beer Institute, first time we ever went to the Beer Institute meeting, at least I ever went, was a very old school meeting, brewers in coats and ties, in Tampa Bay. It was at Busch Gardens down there, and Anheuser-Busch used to put on some pretty lavish parties.
Like, what year around is this?
This was, help me out.
Early 90s.
Yeah, I want to say 91, 92. Later than that, yeah. I'm sorry, yeah. If Boston was 96, it would have been 98.
98.
Yeah, you're right. And I mean, they had people walking around holding big macaws and, you know, parrots just walking around, letting you look at them and touch them. You know, lobster, you know, cold lobster on the buffet, and very, very fancy meeting. And one thing that we all talked about at that time, that we were all struck by, was that Nobody was drinking beer. There was a line that the bar served cocktails, and everybody was drinking cocktails. We were all drinking beer, that which was available, but nobody else was. And that struck us, the craft brewers there, as fairly curious. A couple years later, Norman Adamy came on, and there was another meeting in, it wasn't in St. Louis yet, one of the interim areas, and I can't remember where it was, but I do remember talking to him, meeting him and talking to him and saying, you know, I got a question. You know, this is the Beer Institute, this is the beer industry, everybody's brewers, but nobody's drinking beer. And Norman looked at me and said, in his South African accent, yeah, I know, that's going to change. And he changed it. And a lot of those people didn't work for Miller anymore after that. And if you go to those meetings now, it's a much different look, a much different feel, but people are drinking beer, and that's the only thing that's available. And so if we have contributed anything in this process, maybe that's it. So anyway, maybe I'll dream up some other stories later, but it's been one heck of a ride. Oh, wait, regarding the merger of the two associations, I do have one thing to say. I was the chair of the BAA when we merged, and I read your recent interview, and if you think you can get through this chairmanship, your first chairmanship, and ride off into the sunset, no, doesn't work like that. So, yeah.
I kind of wanted to change the direction of this just a little bit and speak a little bit more directly to the culture. I don't have the.
Who are you?
I'm told that from time to time that I'm John Pinkerton. I don't have the deep history or nearly the gravitas of some of the folks that have come up already. But I came to the AOB experience at the time in 94. I came to my first conference at the Portland conference in 94. And I think that was the conference that goes down in history as the conference where they ended up leaving a brewing system on the curb in front of the hotel. Well, at least that's how it sticks out in my mind. I thought it was brilliant. I thought it was perfectly brilliant. David Edgar was at the helm at the time, I think. Is that right? And Kim has already kind of spoken to this, but I can really summarize my feelings about being a part of all this. When I came to that conference, I was a home brewer. I didn't have a job. And I had joined the AOB as an individual member. And all I really wanted to do out of that conference was to get a job. The only person I knew at that conference was John Mallett.
He didn't have a job either.
John was working at the Old Dominion Brewing Company at the time. And I don't think a whole lot has changed. I think I was driving him crazy the whole time, like, hey, you know, show me who to talk to, blah, blah, blah. I just remember so distinctly walking in and realizing immediately that these were my people. And, you know, over the years, these relationships have developed. I always feel so comfortable around the folks that run the show here with the BA. And I feel so privileged to have develop these relationships over the year, and all the new people that have come on, some people that have moved on since those days. We were talking last night about Casey Kohler, and David Edgar, I guess, is still, you know, part of the family, but I'm pleased to say that he's still in the brewing community. But that's really my story. These are my people, and it goes on and on for me. I feel so privileged to be part of this and to be part of an organization that just works so hard and does such a great job.
I'm Steve Hindy from Brooklyn Brewery, and mine is a cautionary tale. And I believe the statute of limitations is up on the night I'm going to describe. It was 19 years ago, 1993, in New Orleans, the CBC. And I don't know about you, but one of the problems I've had with CBCs is the first night. Because you get there, you're so excited to see all your friends, and everyone has got a beer in his or her hand. And you're all got a lot to catch up on, and the beers just go down quick. And the next morning, I woke up. Actually, I was giving the keynote speech. It wasn't the keynote speech, but at that conference, every day there was a different keynote. So I had to give the speech that day. I woke up with a horrible hangover. So behave yourselves on the first night of any CBC.
All right, I'll give this a quick go. Crispy Fry, representative from the American Homebrew Association, been involved in this in a very short period of time compared to many of these folks, so I'll keep my discussion very short. But I was kind of birthed from the merger. In 2004, thanks to the kindness of Gordon Strong and some other people, I was encouraged to run for the Association of Brewers Board of Advisors. I think that's what it was called back in 2004. And people like Dave Hausman, Gordon Strong, Jamil Zenishev were on this Board of Advisors, and I quickly became aware that it kind of came out of the fact that Charlie was involved in so many things. He was, I think somebody gave me the expression, too much bread and not enough butter. He was doing all these things, and they needed this Board of Advisors to give strategic direction for the American Homebrew Association. Sounded like a pretty lofty goal. About 6 months later, this merger happens. And we're getting all our information filtered through Randy Mosher on the board. And there's a lot of anxiety. There's a lot of concern that, gee, we got 8,500 members. We're bleeding cash. Maybe we're going to get spun off. Maybe we're not relevant. Maybe we should just go away. And, you know, our first task was to get membership. And I thought to myself, well, I ran to get more benefits to the homebrewers, and now I'm being told I need to sell Girl Scout cookies and get more members before we can get money to get more benefits. So it was a dark side, actually, when 2004, 2005, 2006, Paul was director. He was doing a ton of things. He stabilized the membership around, I think, 2006. Gary, you became director, and we got to about 10,000 members. And somebody mentioned it before. There were a lot of kind words before about homebrewers and its interplay, but somebody mentioned before that a very goal-oriented organization. And the goal was we got to be about 15,000 members to break even. And then Gary took over for Paul. Paul got to do other duties, and we got focused on that, and we got there. But there was a long period of anxiety about whether or not we were, I mean, let's face it, this is a trade organization. And has this group over on the side, maybe 20% of it, that are passionate about the hobby. So how does that relate to a trade organization? And I think I heard somebody else say it today. Jesus, isn't it awesome that you've got tens of thousands of people who are really passionate about a hobby behind a trade organization. I mean, I don't think plumbers get this excited and have a bunch of people that are hobbyists. So it's been really, in the 7-8 years I've been involved in the politics, I've been homebrewing for 18 years. I've probably done about 300 batches. I think it was Jim Cook at the Church Key in D.C. 2 years ago, and we're all meeting and getting introduced, and I said, well, I'm not a brewer, I'm just a home brewer. And he said, well, bullshit, you're a brewer, you just know how to monetize it. It was kind of an interesting backhanded compliment, you know. That's right, I'm a gearhead who works for Ford, and it pays for my hobby, to what I do on the weekends. But it's been extremely gratifying to see the growth and the resurgence in the hobby, the passion that we all share, the financial success to get above water, and to grow beyond that, to see Gary's growth, the growth of the hobby as a whole, and I've been very proud of my short involvement with it. Thanks.
You know the party's getting bad when the lawyer goes up to speak. In listening to this, for about the first half, I thought I was going to start in 1998, which was my first BAA meeting. But I have to say this, Pink, you reminded me that my first brewer trade organization work was pro bono for the Rubber Boots Society, and of the four founding members of the Rubber Boots Society, two of them are here. And this was the Mid-Atlantic attempt at creating a beer culture trade organization back in 1995, and I was a young associate going, yeah, you know, hey, I got four kids, I got to send them to college. But this was, I would do anything to be able to work with brewers because I was a complete beer geek and hated the idea of being a lawyer for the rest of my life unless I could do something that was kind of fun. And I also was at your very first beer, Brickskeller beer tasting, the holiday tasting in 1996. But my entree to this organization was in 1998. And Gary Galanis, who had just been appointed to the Brewers Association of America presidency, said, you know, we've got this lawyer, and we think we could maybe get a younger guy, somebody with some more energy, some more, you know, ideas, and why don't you come on by? So I did, and came to Boulder and had a wonderful time. I rode the shuttle from the airport to the hotel with Fritz Maytag, and I'm sitting there going, wow, this is my dream. You know, I'm talking to Fritz Maytag, and he's telling me about, you know, his stories and just learning from a legend. It was just a wonderful experience, but my completely over-the-top experience in this industry has to be this. The One Voice Committee was trying to negotiate all sorts of very difficult things. It was a very tense meeting. I think it was Baltimore 2001. I'm pretty sure it was Baltimore, and so some of the things that Kim and Ken had talked about were happening, which was this discussion of trying to get the AOB and the BAA together. And so it was a discussion that was coming into some of the very intense disputes about whether you're going to include the home brewers, et cetera. And early days of the cell phone, people didn't have cell phone etiquette, and Jack Joyce's phone goes off. And he stands up, picks up his phone, pauses, looks around the room, says, I hate assholes like me. And then he takes the call. It was just absolutely and completely and completely brilliant. It was a wonderful moment, but it really has been a great ride for me in the last now 15 plus or minus years, getting to see the craft brewing industry. I remember when the BAA was at our first, or my first meeting where we were representing the small brewers at a TTB meeting, and there was four people from Anheuser-Busch and four people from Miller, and I think three people from Coors. There's two people from Stroh, two people from Heilemann, and then me and Gary Galanis. And at one point, when they were talking about malt liquors, somebody suggested, well, you know, malt liquors really aren't any of our companies. It's the small, you know, it's those small brewers. And every eye in the room turned to us. And there was, like, you know, Art Libertucci, head of the ATF at the time, you know, looking at us. And we were just like, oh, please, no, really, we don't make malt liquor. So to go from that time to now, when we are so recognized, so well-connected in Washington and really making some strides, has been a lot of fun. So thanks, everybody in this room, for making my career as a lawyer a hell of a lot of fun. I've had a great ride so far. I'm hoping it'll be a great ride in the future. And thanks.
Are you done joking?
Say your name. Dick,
that was Mark Serrini from McDermott, Will & Emery, our legal counsel. I'm Dick Cantwell from Elysian Brewing. Anyway, I want to take it back to, Steve sort of jogged my memory. I want to take it back to the same year that he was talking about, 1993, and to show that the apple doesn't fall far from the tree, top to bottom, within any organization, because within a few months, probably, of his cutting the Miller Lite bottle, I was at GABF for my second GABF ever, so that was 1993. And in those days, there was a bar that was sort of across the railroad tracks called the High Line that a lot of the brewers, I worked for Pike Place Brewery at the time, used to go to shoot pool and drink beer and all that stuff. And you can't really walk right across the railroad tracks through that part of town right now, because in those days, you know, what's now Lodo was just a, I don't know, I haven't been to Beirut, but it was pretty grim. We were coming back from having been down there, and as we crossed the railroad tracks, there was a gang of us, and Garrett Oliver, that's why I bring Steve up, was among us. Fal Allen, my friend who has been all over the place, I was working with him then, and now he's at Anderson Valley, of course. Other people, Kevin Forehand, who's now with the Ram, was at Big Time as well. And Ed Tringali from Big Time. Greg Noonan was in the group. A couple of other people. And as we came across the tracks, we found an Amtrak engine idling. And I don't know, I try to be a good boy, but Garrett especially was really, really interested in getting inside the train and seeing if we could get it going. And there were other people who were really into that too. So we did get into the engine compartment, the cabin, whatever you call it, of the train, and we succeeded in revving the engine pretty impressively. And Garrett was determined to put it into gear and take it out of there. So you know, we did various things. They went through various algorithms of intent, and fortunately, did not really succeed in really getting it going. And then at one point we noticed that there was an opposing train idling right in front of us. So sort of the crowning thing was I got into one engine and somebody else was in the other, and we were blowing the horns at each other. And so of course at that point we had to leave. And the police descended on the site. And we just barely got away. Went to Wincoop. Huh?
We got away.
And You know, the rest of that GABF sort of melts into, you know, non-memory. But a couple of weeks later, a week and a half later, when I was back at work at Pike Place, we got an envelope in the mail, and it was on Amtrak. It was Amtrak stationery, and it was marked Criminal Investigation Department.
And I opened it up, and it was from Greg Noonan. He had taken pictures and included all of those. But anyway, so that was the same year that Steve was doing that with the Miller Lite bottle. So it's not surprising that they've been so successful. It was. So anyway, fast forward. Later on, I think it was the first San Diego conference, Brock Wagner, whom I'd known for a number of years, came up and talked to me about how I should consider putting my name up for, some sort of governance position with the BA, and I'm not sure whether, I think it took me a year or two to do that. So I think at that point, the merger was still yet to be effected. And so eventually I did, and I was elected, and I didn't really know most of you at that point. You know, of course I knew Sam, and I knew Mark, and I knew Mallet, of course, from way back. Pinkerton, I judged with you. Nancy, of course, a lot of staff people. I knew Charlie and Paul. But, I came to this not really knowing the luminaries with whom I was going to be, sharing this fairly exalted position. And I was, pretty cowed by that, although it didn't stop me from making jokes about how I was going to be serving with Kim Gordon from Sonic Youth. Stupid jokes. I had not yet met Kim when I first arrived in Boulder. What was that? What year was that, Mark, that we started? 2006?
2006.
Yeah, 2006. Yep, we were the freshman class. Yeah, that's right. Anyway, so, of course, I'm very, very happy that that happened and that the way things developed with Kim, Jordan, not Gordon. I have to say it's just contributed a great deal of maturity, insight, and I don't know what else, but all good things that have come from my involvement in this organization with my personal life, my business, my awareness, from having been sort of one of those guys who, crusts around about what's going on with the mucky mucks and the governance and all that stuff, and really learning the lessons of some of the diplomatic things that we're called upon to be wise about and make decisions about, and not shoot quite so quickly from the hip. It's been a real honor to be involved with that. I was going to close with something that I'm not remembering right now. Just give me a second. Oh, it was such a great close too. I'll have to come back. I'll close a little later. I'll come back up and do that later.
Okay. I've just got a quick. I've got a quick story. So, and actually, it was just reminded me of it. It was pretty hilarious. So, those of you who remember Bob Weinberg, So Bob was the industry analyst who actually tried to help August the 3rd take over from Gussie Bush. Anheuser-Busch, and he was a extremely brilliant PhD from, I don't know where he graduated. I think he got his PhD at 19, I think, something like that. And he was one of the earliest PhD graduates, and he worked for IBM, and Anheuser-Busch had hired IBM to help him. No, IBM. When Anheuser-Busch hired him, it was IBM. They hired him to do some analysis, and he ended up getting a job offer from Anheuser-Busch he couldn't refuse. At least that's the story he told me. So if you know something different, Steve, you'll have to get up next. But anyway, a brilliant guy. And I remember being very pissed off when I was writing my original business plan in 1978 because he had predicted that by the year 2000 there'd be three brewing companies left in America. And I was trying to get money from banks. And they saw that, okay, there's 40 now, there's only going to be three from this industry guy, and I'm not going to loan you money. And so I knew him before I knew him. But anyway, so he gave a talk at a CBC in San Diego in 87, I don't know what year, but maybe later than that, maybe in the early 90s. And he used to have, what year? 2004? So he had these very elaborate log charts on, the history of the industry and growth and the the population growth and certain demographics, and he would predict, you know, everything to the nth degree. 200-page decks for some of those who would sit through them. And so Fritz is out in the audience, and Fritz was the next speaker up, and he's watching Bob Weinberg give this talk about log charts, and I did this in log form because I could fit it all on one chart. So Fritz gets up. Actually, I think during the break, Fritz asked if there was an overhead projector, one of the ones that you'd put the plastic on that you could write on, you know, back from high school. And so the hotel, they found this, you know, overhead projector, and Fritz has got the, you know, the plastic sheet, and he's drawing a picture of a log. And it takes a while for people to figure out what he's drawing. He's, you know, he's drawing this thing, and he's got bark on it and all that. And this is my log chart, and you could see Bob Weinberg on it. It's just fuming, and you know, I've got my own log, and it's different than Bob Weinberg's log chart. So anyway, that was a memorable moment. It was pretty funny, and I guess Bob Weinberg was pissed at Fritz for years after that. But that's my story. It's quick.
My addition to that was I rode the cab to the airport with Bob Weinberg after that and heard him absolutely fuming, just flipping out about Fritz, saying, you know, he could have done this and he could have done that, and, you know, if I'd been running that brewery, it would be Sam Adams. And you know, he was just absolutely, completely furious, so... That was my memory of that.
That conference, I remember.
Jump up. Go up there.
I just one little thing that no one noticed. I was the guy in the frog costume that came on stage when David Bruce gave a talk, and he's giving the middle of his talk. I came out as a frog in a frog costume. So that's my crazy moment.
Cindy's saying nothing like that happens at our conferences anymore. Someone draws a log on an overview. Someone jumps up as a frog. We got to get more creative with our conferences. Go ahead, Paul.
Just wait till the Gordians come back up again this year. So I want to do one with my friend Eric Wallace here. But before we get going, I want to talk about prehistory. You know, the Brewers Association of America had their first meeting at Palmer House in Chicago back on July 10th, 1942. And back when the merger happened, we here at the Association of Brewers, now the Brewers Association, received all the documents, all the old files and folders, and I think I'm the only nerd who's gone through all that old stuff. Back around 1944, there's reference to some of the efforts of some of the small brewers to change the excise tax so that small brewers would have a lower rate than the large brewers, referencing 1938. Then around 1956, there was another effort made for setting the limit at 100,000 barrels for small brewers, where they would pay a $2 lower excise tax than the brewers larger than 100,000 barrels. Then that same proposal came up again around 1973, 1974, and it got morphed into a 60,000 barrel number in 1975, and it actually got passed. And I was looking at the old documents, really in November of 1975, there was not a belief that this thing was going to pass. There was talk about them, you know, reintroducing it in the next Congress, and should they, you know, do the same number. And in December, like within a two-week period, the landscape had changed. It was going through, and it went through, and was signed by the president in early January of 1976 or the end of 75, one of the two, and it just kind of happened. So that made the excise tax for small brewers down from $9 a barrel that the large brewers were paying to $7. And then in 91, the federal government was looking for some money, so they raised the large brewer tax up to 18 for over 60,000 barrels. And that's where we are today, and we're, you know, still working on it, still hammering it. Go Bob Pease. All right, so I want to go back to 1992. I applied for a job at the Association of Brewers for director of the Great American Beer Festival, and about
13 weeks later after applying, I got a letter back saying, sorry, we got a lot of applications and you're not the guy. But then, so 1993, the same week, I got hired at both Boulder Beer and What's Brewing Homebrew Supply in Boulder. You know, one of my early stories is for the National Homebrew Day's Eve rooftop party, I got a call at like 3:30 from Caroline Dunker saying, our beer's not carbonated, what do we do? I'll be right over. That was my first emergency service, and got the beer carbonated for the party. But also these two punks came into the shop, a little bit older than me, hippies. And every week they would come into the shop and they'd buy the same damn ingredients, you know, all grain brewers. So that instantly, you know, in 1993, that instantly got, you know, some respect. Okay, all grain brewers, good. And they kept buying the same thing. It's like, I'm thinking to myself, don't these guys like want to brew something different each week? You know, they get the same beer at their house every time, and they kept doing it, And finally, I'm like, all right, these guys are up to something. And sure enough, they don't tell you a damn word about it. And I read about in the paper that there's going to be a brewery opening up in Longmont, Colorado, and. A little bit later, you know, the same week I got really got close to a friend who came in the shop. I hear you can brew your own beer. What do? How do I do it? I'm so psyched. I want to do this. A guy named Brian Lutz, and you know, just talking to him, and then I was talking to Eric Wallace and his brewing partner Dick Dorr, and they're like, we started this brewery in Longmont. It's called Left Hand Brewing Company, and things are going well, and we need to hire somebody. Do you know anybody? And I thought, oh, let's put two and two together, and you know, went on from there. Oh, Brian Lutz got to be a good friend of his on a very snowy night in November here in Boulder in 1993, where he was bartending at La Estrelita, where Redfish, Las Oasis, and now Shine, the newest brewery in Boulder, came in. And so I skied down the Pearl Street Mall to go see my friend Brian. Sat at the end of the bar, and he was one of the few places in Boulder that had Fat Tire, a beer from a small brewery in Fort Collins, I think it is. And he's like, yeah, Fat Tire, it's got this waiting list of like 50 bars before they'll even add to the brewing, and then they'll release it to more bars. I'm like, cool, this tastes pretty damn good. And so with that, let me turn it over to Eric.
Yeah, let me tell you how it really happened. We knew we were going to have two different versions of this story. And let's kick it back to Dick and I were starting a brewery. I'd moved back to the States from Italy, and he'd been traveling in South Asia and India for 6 months and had lost something like 60 or 80 pounds and came back looking like a skeleton. He had some kind of intestinal thing going on. So he had to get back to the States. And so we hooked back up in Niwot with another friend of ours. All three of us had been at the Air Force Academy together in the 80s and in the same squadron. So that's where we knew each other from, and that's how it all kind of came together. I had moved back to the States with my wife in 93, April 93. And we'd traveled from New Orleans, picked up my car there that I'd shipped back over, and basically visited every brewery I could find between New Orleans and Homer, Alaska. And by the time I got back, we spent the summer up in Alaska, and by the time we ended up back in Niwot, and I figured, well, this brewing Homer?
Niwot.
Niwot. People know where Homer is. Come on. Niwot? People don't know where Niwot is? Everyone knows where Niwot is. It's halfway between here and Longmont. Come on. And we're living in Niwot. We ended up back here, and I'm just, Dick, you got to teach me how to homebrew. This thing's going to happen. I mean, I got a fever. He's like, all right, so we started homebrewing together, and then one night after drinking a bunch of homebrews, he's like, dude, we need to start a brewery. And I got enough beer into him where he actually said, yeah, that sounds like a good idea. So we started home brewing, and we needed to do a bunch of test brews. We had a couple of ideas, and that's where Paul and What's Brewing come in. And we were down there. Yeah, we were all grain brewing twice a week, and we were brewing very similar recipes. Yes, that's all pretty much in parallel. And he's kind of looking at us weird, and we know what's going on. He's suspecting that something is going on. But we'd ask for some advice. Hey, what about this? What about that? And he, very knowledgeable dude. He's helping us out. And we would brew these batches up, and we were brewing them into six barrels. We had those ones with the green vinyl on them, you know. We'd shake them up. We'd force carbonate because we're not doing bottles. We're all grain kegging brewers, and we're not messing around. And we'd have all the neighbors come in and test all of our batches for us. We'd take notes, and we'd see what we did right and what we did incorrectly. And finally came in, I think we came in actually with a case of beer or something. It's like, dude, check this out. This is what we've been working on. And it's left hand. And we announced ourselves to Paul. I think we ran over to IBS AOB at the same time. It's like, hey, a new brewery in town. And introduced them also at the same time. So Paul kind of was there at the advent of left hand. Little did we know to what heights he was going to rise through the years. And I have to give, for those of the few of you in the room that know him, a shout out to John Arthur, who was a pioneer in this area, you know, in the homebrew shop. He also opened a shop out in Longmont for a few years, and left us a few years ago. So to John, and in the Air Force, you drink to the dead with water. I guess that's appropriate. I've got water in my glass, but to John Arthur. The Brian Lutz story, he told this is the way it really went down. And I'm sure there's some truth in his version also, but let us compare the two versions and see where the nexus is. I was delivering beer in the summer of 94 to La Estrella, where Brian was the guy that tended bar, and it was about 194 degrees that day, and I'm schlepping in cases of beer, and I'm sweating my ass off, and Brian's like, hey dude, you guys hiring, you know, out there in left hand? And I look at him, it's like, hiring? I think we had one employee at that time other than Dick and me and my wife working for free. It's like, hiring? It's like, you want to do this? If you want to do this, I'm hiring. You come out and see me tomorrow. And Brian Lutz came out the next day, and I hired him to do this. It's like, you get in the assault vehicle, and you go deliver all the beer, and I will be a happy camper. So that's my version of how Brian Lutz ended up working at Left Hand, was, you want to do this? Yeah.
I'd like to hear his version.
I'm sure he's got a different version.
I'm going to jump in real quick to invite Ray, who runs this joint. And as you're enjoying these pairings tonight, obviously a lot of thought went into these pairings. And as we drink our beer out of what some people would call wine glasses, I'd say the right glasses to smell and drink your beers. I think it's important that we celebrate the place that we're enjoying this meal at tonight for being pioneers in this community, for recognizing that beers is deserving for the highest end pair choices or food choice pairings as wine is. And you guys in Boulder have been in the forefront of this. And can you talk about this menu a little bit tonight, Ray?
Thank you.
Well, how's it going tonight?
Really great.
All right. Cool. You know, this is definitely a really special night for us. So I just want to first thank you all for coming and thinking of us when you're holding this dinner. You know, it's definitely, I mean, as somebody who loves beer and is and very involved in the craft beer industry, just from somebody who loves to drink it, but also from, you know, just sharing a passion that you all bring to the table is just incredible. So to have you all in this room dining with us tonight is, it couldn't be a better treat for us. So just thank you for coming in tonight.
If you need
So this meal, it was quite the ride today. It was fun. No pressure. No, the beers, Bob and I had been communicating and Sam had been communicating over the last couple weeks, and we knew that the beers were going to start to arrive, and wasn't sure exactly what they were all going to be. So we did a pre-meeting, and just Ashley and Dennis, who are our executive chefs tonight, and put the meal together for you. We came together a couple weeks ago, and we were thinking structurally, like, all right, let's at least get the structure of this menu down, and we wanted to make it really special. We knew that we were going to be doing this prime rib, and for me, this is from a ranch northeast of Boulder called Corbenstein. We are lucky enough to be working with this farm. We've been working with them since November, and basically the program that we have is we are purchasing whole cows from them, and Dennis has actually been to the plant and where they're processing this meat, and it's a really special relationship that we've had. And so we're purchasing these cows, and we're using every single piece of the cow. I mean, we're serving heart and the tongue. I mean, we're going to town on it. And we've had this prime rib before, and to me, it was probably the best prime rib we've ever had. So when we're talking about this menu, we're like, we gotta do prime rib from Corbenstein. So this is kind of what brought this this course to fruition. But we had the structure of the menu down, and we were feeling really good about it. We knew that we wanted to do the scallops and the caviar and bring in some black truffle. And then today, we had all of the beers, and we're like, all right, well, everything finished coming in last night. We're like, all right, well, let's meet today at noon, and we'll taste all the beers, and we'll just dial it all in. So I think the course that we just had, I hope you all enjoyed that course. When Kim emailed me and told me that she was sending a keg of the kick, I mean, we were super psyched on that. But then we're also like, all right, sour. All right, it's definitely not one of those styles of beer that is just a no-brainer. You can throw it up on anything. So getting together with and Stefan as well, the four of us, started tasting. We literally had a bag of black truffles, unpeeled. And we had the kick next to it, and we're smelling this bag of truffles and then getting into the kick, and there was such a similarity in those smells. There was a really earthy pungency that was coming from both the truffle and the beer. We're like, all right, this is definitely going with the second course. Like, we're going to do the shaved black truffles on top, and we're going as rich as we can get. We're hoping that acid and the sour would do a nice kind of cleanse, but that truffle, that earth component, and that rich rabbit would also, kind of round out the dish. So I hope that came through. It was good? All right, sweet. Awesome. Cool, and, I think probably the best part about my job, I know you're all sharing stories about craft beer. I think if I could share one, it would, just having this opportunity to come and work for the kitchen. I started back in 2005, and shortly after that, I had the opportunity to start purchasing the beer. And one of the first couple of things I did was I got rid of Amstel Light and Stella. And I remember we were selling Stella like it was, yeah. We were selling so much Stella, it was ridiculous. And when I told the staff we were taking off the menu, like, what? You're taking Stella? Well, I can't believe it. I'm like, there is life after Stella. We'll forget about it. And at the time, we were closed up here on Sunday and Monday, so we had the space. It was completely wide open. And so we had an opportunity to do our first beer dinner with Avery. And we did this, like, you know, completely over the top. It was a 5-course, 2 beers per course. You know, we ended up with Mephistopheles and the Beast, I think, on our last course. And it was just crazy. But to me, that was, like, you know, the first time where I, you know, saw, you know, the opportunity or just the, you know, the compatibility with amazing beer and great food. And so since having that dinner, we've had you know, numerous dinners up here, and it's always such a treat to have this opportunity to just share it with people that are really into food and beer. And I will tell one quick story about Sam. When we first did a dinner up here with Sam, he gets up, and I think his first beer of the night was the 3rd course. And I think they had started at the West End Tavern before they came here. So they're all feeling pretty good. And Sam gets up, and you know, we got a full house, and he goes, "You know how I know I'm at a beer dinner? Because none of you mother effers are wearing, or he's like, none of you mother effers are wearing a tie." And he just drops the F bomb, and everybody just like burst up. I mean, that was my introduction to Sam and having him up here. So, yeah, dude, he was like, yeah, so cool. At bombs. So thank you very much, guys. I hope you enjoy the rest of the meal. And yeah, it's a great treat. And I do just real quick, just want to recognize Ashley and Dennis in the back. They're going to come out too. There's they're definitely the creators behind this meal and executing it, and so I can't speak highly enough of both of these guys. I mean, they've both been with the restaurant for quite a while, and you know, Dennis works primarily downstairs, and Ashley's up here, and their food is just amazing, and it's, you know, it definitely it's such a treat to work with them, and also Stefan and the staff too. So thank you very much, guys.
Thank you, Ray.
So I don't have that many good old stories. I've been in business. Sam's kind of got to be here for this, but whatever. I'll start talking. But I've been in business 17 years. The first 10 or so years, I pretty much had my head buried in the sand at Allagash Brewing, just trying to make a living. And I never even went to a lot of the old CBC conferences originally and GABF. I just couldn't go to them. And I went to the last of the BAA conferences, which I think was in New Orleans. And my biggest memory of that is basically hooking up with Eric, which we hardly knew each other at the time. We got together and ended up in the... Yeah. But we got together and ended up hooking up and ended up in the hookah bar. Remember that place, Eric?
Mark Cerini, do you remember the hookah bar? So,
but anyway, was he there? We showed up the hookah bar probably 10 at night, didn't leave till 2 or 3 in the morning, and then, what's that? That was a good spot, and Eric basically every single night after that gave me a call and said, "Dude, we're going to the hookah bar," so we hung out at the hookah bar. But I was just waiting for the bathrooms there, and Sam popped out, and I was talking with Julia. I had nothing to say tonight, but I was saying to Julia, I was like, "Wow, you know, we've grown up. I can't believe Sam, who's, you know, kind of my peer, is what's the position, chairman or whatever of the Brewers Association. You know, I'm proud of you, man. It's cool." And I immediately just thought back to this story at the brewery. It was probably 97 or 98, and we had a little forehead Mahin filler, which maybe some of the newer people like Sam and my generation had. And the machine was a pain in the ass. We had a Mahin filler. Then we had this little labeler before we graduated to a World Tandem labeler, which we sold to Ken, which hopefully is going to get restored. But this Enos, the labeler was the Enos labeler, and it had some picker arms like the Tandem, and we fondly called it, or not so fondly called it, the Pinos labeler. We hated it. Can I say we hated the fire. It was a nightmare. But basically, I mean, anyone who... Yeah, people who started on those old lines, the labels were constantly coming out crooked, and it used to drive me crazy, because whenever I was working on the outfeed of the bottling line, if a label came off crooked, I'd straighten it, you know, so it was just right, horizontal, and it used to piss me off that the other people at the company would let labels go through sometimes crooked. So I was doing a ride within Massachusetts right after one of these runs. I was mad that people are letting these labels go through crooked, and I was looking on the shelves, and I was like, I'm going to buy a six-pack of beer, a craft beer, where the labelers are just unbelievably crooked from some craft brewery that's never going to make it, bring it back to the brewery and call an all-company meeting. So anyway, I grabbed a six-pack of beer, brought it back to the brewery, we bottled beer, and then I called an all-company meeting, which was four of us, basically all of us working on the bottling line, and pulled out the six-pack of beer and, you know, put the beers out in front of everyone and said, you know, guys, and of course people were letting crooked labels go through. I was like, guys, let's not end up like these guys. These guys are not going to make it. In all six of the bottles, not one of the labels was even semi-horizontal. They were probably a half an inch off. I mean, it was horrible. It had a crafty look to it, but the labels were all over the place. I think Sam knows whose beer it was. But I said, these guys are not going to make it. It was a six-pack of Indian brown ale. So, but the crew, the guys that are still there, a couple of the guys are still there for the brewery. So they still give me shit about it. They're like, oh, this is one of the most successful breweries in the country. So anyway, that's my story. But, I think it's cool that someone in our generation now is running the chairman of the BA. You did a good job today too, dude. Yeah, don't screw up. So
I'm standing on the shoulders of giants, and I feel that, you know, today was a very nervous day for me to do my first meeting as chairman, and sitting in the room with all of you made me less nervous as every moment went on. I'll tell a little story about one of the people in the room that made me feel less nervous in his company. I didn't think about this until 2 minutes ago when Rob said that. It's one of my earliest meetings to get distribution when we moved from being a brew pub to a production brewery and we started bottling. And I was like, I was born in New York. It'd be so cool to sell new beer in New York someday. And I went up and met with Steve and Tom Potter. I just remember they were vetting our opportunities to work with their distribution company, and they pulled out a bottle out of what I sent up ahead. And I think it was Tom. I don't think it was Steve that was there in that meeting. And he's like, is every six-pack that you're going to have, are some of the bottles going to have rubber bands instead of glue to hold the labels on? And I was like, I don't know. It depends on if we had glue that day. And then he also said, as I look across the six-pack, the fill heights are very different. And I said, yeah, but they average 12 ounces. Suffice to say, Brooklyn Distributing did not pick up Dogfish Head in 1997.
I have a very quick Dogfish one because since he's opening himself up, we were a wholesaler for 7 years, and I remember we got a shipment of Dogfish in. It's like, here's this new, it's called Dogfish Head. It's like Dogfish Head, okay. Let's try it. And there was a 750 bottle, and it had this bald dude slamming a nail in through his nostril. And we looked at the bottle and go, this is some sick dudes making this beer. And then we tasted it, and two of us went out on the loading. We were in an office near the loading dock. We went out on the loading dock, spit it out. It's like, what the fuck? It's like it was this beer. It had been continuously hopped for 90 minutes, and we're like, it's like, these guys are never gonna make it. And we were flabbergasted. We didn't know what to make of it. In the end, we ended up selling their beer. I think we sold a bit of your beer, but. Yeah, that was our first introduction to Sam's beer. It's like, oh my God, this is like a label with a dude shoving a nail into his head. That's what how we felt when we tasted it.
Well, as long as we're roasting our chair, we might never get it this opportunity. My first memory of Dogfish is one of those All About Beers that I get for the All About Beer reviews way back when. I get this beer called Dogfish Head, and all I could think of is a dead fish with the head cut off, and why would anybody name their beer after a fish head?
We did.
Sam, you ever told the Battle of
the
Band story from New Orleans?
Oh, okay. I'm Gary Glass. So I'm going to dig back for me. Many of our fellow managers here long predate me, but I came in at a very special time in the Association of Brewers history. I was there to feel the thump when we hit the bottom.
What year is this, Gary?
2000. I started my first day, January 4th.
40,000 in your checking account, 420,000 due on 18.
So I didn't quite catch all the numbers, but yes, we were in tight times. I, of course, hired January 4th, 2004, my first day. I had no idea. Like, I had no idea what kind of condition the association was in. I had interviewed for the job in December. I was a homebrewer, been homebrewer for many years, and I remember like calling my friend who I had taught how to homebrew, became a professional brewer. I said, I'm applying for this job for the Association of Brewers. Do you have any idea what that, you know, What this is all about? And I'm like, well, that's Charlie's company, Charlie Papazian. And I'm like, oh shit, Charlie Papazian! Oh my God! So I went in and interviewed. Paul was in the office. Bob was in the office during the interview. The only reason I got the job was because I had actually entered a homebrew competition. The only time I'd enter one entry in a homebrew competition. My only infection to that date was that entry in that homebrew competition, but it got me the job, so I'm thankful for that particular beer. So I start. It's, you know, in the AHA office. I was the AHA administrator. Paul Gatso was the AHA director, and that was it. Like, it was just me and Paul in that AHA office, like big space. And when I started, I was like, well, you know. You need pencils or pens or whatever. Like, there's desks everywhere. Just go look, and you'll find stuff. And I did. Like, I didn't really think of anything about at the time. There were lots of empty desks back then. So I went and got my pens and pencils and pads of paper, and you know, I got to work, and I actually had some time on my hands. I was running a national homebrew competition, but we didn't have a whole lot going on right then. We were down like 9,000 members or something, coming down from about 20,000 members in about 5 years' time. So I launched my own little project on, you know, homebrew clubs and colleges and whatnot. So, you know, just kind of a reminder to me, like, back then we had time to do things, and like just come up with like, yeah, this is a cool idea. Like, well, maybe I'll try this. Yeah, we don't have so much time anymore. But I really want to relate to you, like the empty desk syndrome. Like, I had no idea. I was just really excited. I was working for the company that Charlie Papazian founded. So that was my introduction to the Homebrewers Association. We had 5 years of kind of bouncing along. I took over as director in 2006. I have very strong memories of that first conference that I had as director. It was in Orlando. My best memories of that conference in Orlando was the end of the conference, when me and the rest of the
Association of Brewers, or we were the Brewers Association staff at that point. We're kind of recovering from that experience. We ended up losing $8,000 at the conference in Orlando, which was a very stressful thing for me as the very new director of the AHA, knowing that the AHA was potentially on the chopping block here. Like, we had to prove ourselves. I just lost $8,000. A little stressful time. So I had a bonding moment with our staff after not having any idea what I was doing running a conference in Orlando. So that was a particularly fond memory. And fast forward to 2011, lost $8,000 in 2006. 2011, we saw 50% growth in our attendance. That's kind of a rather extraordinary turnaround in a very short time. And something else that happened at that 2006 conference that really has a lot to do with that was the year that Randy Mosier was elected as the chair of the governing committee. And things really turned around for the AHA with the governing committee becoming much more involved. And I can't tell you, the governing committee has had so much to do with where we have come in those years. I mean, our staff is really good at executing, but it was the governing committee that came up with these crazy ideas, like launching a new website. Why would we do that? Sure enough, the rest of the Brewers Association kind of thought that was a good idea. Maybe we should do that. Maybe we should. We ended up launching not only homebrewersassociation.org, but craftbeer.com and brewersassociation.org, and all are tremendously successful websites. And that really came out of the conversations that came out of having a strong leader in the governing committee. And then, taking over after Randy, Crispy Fry, who's now on the board, has continued that and really driven home a very passionate, successful governing committee that has helped us lead the American Home Brewers Association to where it has been. So I'm really thankful that the timing that we had, and of course a very kind of stressful time from having been kind of like bouncing along for a while, and then oh crap. Got to turn things around in a very, very, very fast time. And then being given the resources by the Brewers Association board to actually have that chance. Because it could have easily been that, now this is an organization that's not making any money, losing money. We were given that chance, and we made the most of that opportunity. So that. Weeks?
Yeah, how many weeks?
Why aren't we talking hours? 46 hours. I wish I could have foreseen that 50% growth last year in 2010 when I booked our Seattle venue. Thankfully, we've got room to grow next year. Well, I'm pretty certain we'll sell out again. There was one other thing that I did want to bring up as just kind of an extraordinary moment that stuck in my head was being in a meeting in our conference room at one point where we were talking about terminology that we should use for the industry in general, because at the time I don't even remember what year it was, but we were talking about, people are calling us microbrewers, and that's not really that's not a sexy term, not something that's going to get us to the next level. And I distinctly remember that having that conversation in that conference room. And Ray Daniels saying, what about make craft beer? Craft brewing. And I'm sure it's not the first time that term ever came up, but that was that moment where it was like, okay, that's what we're going to refer to it as. It's not microbrewing anymore, it's craft brewing. And that happened in that office just down the street. That happened. And now, like when you see it covered, you see our industry covered in the press, it's craft beer. And that was something that happened right down there. That's where it happened. It's pretty something that's always stuck with me. So, no, thanks.
Yeah, I had to go because I'm having too many beers and I can't wait any longer. But I'm listening to all the stories. A lot of degrees of separation here, or a few degrees. And Tom reminded me back, I grew up in New Jersey, and at the time in 79, 80, when you could underage drink at 16, that we used to buy this thing called a beer ball, which was a round plastic thing, and the only people in New Jersey selling them were the FX Matt Company, and you could buy Utica Club beer balls, and it was amazing. So I had to shout out to Nick to starting with that. Woo, exactly. But congratulations to Sam for his first day, and he started it off on such a great foot today, and it's something that I will always remember. He said that he is as proud being the chairman today as he is running Dogfish, as the president of Dogfish. And I sat there and I thought, you know what? I feel the same way. You know, I am so proud to serve on this board and give back to such an industry that has fulfilled, my dreams. I mean, if Iron Hill were to go out of business today, I would say that I have had 15 years of fulfillment of dreams that I couldn't even imagine. I started, again, as a home brewer like many in the room, just to kind of go back, my partner Kevin and I decided, well, we're very good home brewers, and we decided, let's see what this industry is about. And we decided to go to a GABF, which is the worst thing to go if you want to try to figure out how to start a business. But it was 19...
We'll edit the record. Yeah. Pull that out.
Which was in 1991 we came out here, and it was at the Merchandise Mart, and we had a great time, but we realized that, they have this conference, so we ought to try that. That might be a... And our first conference, again, another nexus here, is 1993 in New Orleans. I heard a lot of stories about them. And that was our first conference. And there's three people that I remember meeting. One was, I remember going up to the registration desk, and there was a brand new IBS employee at the time who was registering us, and that was Nancy Johnson. and Lori Tolberg and Lori Tolberg Kelly were the two new employees, and we became very good friends with them, and a friendship that has lasted many years. The second thing is, we got on the bus tour, right, which was everywhere. We went across Lake Pontchartrain to Abita, and we went to Dixie, where we almost passed out from ammonia fumes from the refrigeration system. But I sat on the bus for the trip right next to Charlie Papazian, and I sat down there. I was like every home brewer, right? And yeah. And here's a guy who I've read all his books, and I'm sitting next to him, and I met actually at the Crescent City Brewhouse on the upstairs patio out front, Ed and Carol Stout, who have encouraged my partner and I well before we opened, and we've been great friends ever since. And that first conference, the one thing that we realized, and I said it today, was that this is an industry of collaboration, where you meet people who are excited about helping you become successful and be their competition. And it's not about competition, it's about growing the pie. And so we went back, and unfortunately I hear that the average year is 2 years for starting up, for these startups, and I remember going to four conferences and still not have opened Iron Hill. And we were like, oh God. And in Delaware, Yes, and in Delaware, there was this big competition going on who was going to be the first, right? And, of course, it was all of us up in New Castle County because outside in Delaware, you know, if you're not in New Castle County, you're just in Slower Delaware. And so there was four of us, and we all kind of knew each other. We were trying to open a brew pub and eyeballing each other. And then out of left field, this jackass down in Rehoboth on a Sabco system opens this little brew pub with this name that was ridiculous, you know, this Dogfish Head. We're like, what was that? Who is that? You know? And Sam was the first, and we were the fourth. But
having our conference, yes. Our first festival.
Yep, yes, Delaware's having its first festival coming up. Absolutely, absolutely. And that's great. And I have to say, again, I've been on the board now since 2006, right after the merger. Dick and I and Vinny were the freshman brew pub inaugurations there. And I've just been so proud to be involved with this and to give back to an industry that has given so much to me, for personal fulfillment, to our company and to our employees. And this is great, and so that's what I want to say. Thank you.
I'm Nancy Johnson. I'm the event director at the Brewers Association, and thank you, Sam, for making me get up here because I'm not very comfortable speaking in front of a large group, but I love having one-on-one. This is okay. I'm among friends. I'm part of the class of '93. At the Brewers Association. I'm stealing Bob's thunder again. I started working at the Brewers Association in March of 1993, about, I think, 3 months after Tom Clark, and I think about 3 months before Bob Pease, and about a year maybe before Stephanie Johnson.
95.
Okay, 2 years. 2 years. So anyway, class of 93, I keep hearing stories about the New Orleans conference, and that was my first conference. I came to work at the Brewers Association after having a short career in the insurance industry, thinking, God, I have got to find something else to do, shortly after college. So I answered an ad for a $6 an hour part-time or a temporary registrar with somebody, I didn't know who it was, and came to work at the Association of Brewers. Karen Barella and Jeff Mendel hired me, and went to the New Orleans conference about 3 months after I started there. After I think the first registrar decided to just get rid of the database. I think she was angry about something and blew up the database and walked out the door and said she was going to feed the parking meter maybe and then never came back. So I had all these stories going, wow, this is interesting, but I'll just hang out here until I find a real job 19 years ago. So, you know, we end up in New Orleans and they're telling me, yeah, there's going to be about 300 people at this conference. You just need to register everybody and then make sure all the exhibitors are good. And there were 600 people at the conference in New Orleans. So that was my first experience of, wow, double the number. It was the early 90s, not the late 90s, and things were going pretty good. So my first experience was New Orleans again, and I remember being at Crescent City and thinking, wow, these are really fun people. My other story from that year was David Geary was there, and I haven't heard his name yet, but I know a lot of you know him. And my job was to, of course, register everybody, and so I'd end the day and then go up to my hotel room and start entering everything into the database. And about midnight, 1 o'clock in the morning, there's a knock at my door, and it's Lori Tolberg, who was our marketing director at the time, and David Geary, saying, come on, we're going out to Bourbon Street. So I was like, okay. I was like, okay. So that was, I did used to go out really late. So we go out and we're walking down Bourbon Street and we're seeing music and I'm thinking, wow, this is really fun. And David Geary all of a sudden says, there's my brother. unbeknownst to him, his brother was in New Orleans at the time, too. So it was just one of these weird, I said, did you know your brother was going to be here? No, he didn't. And anyway, so that's just kind of a side note. So anyway, New Orleans was a great experience for me, and I thought, wow, I would love to make this a full-time job, and that did happen. And you know, part of that was, again, what everybody's kind of been saying here is the people. It's just a great community, and having been here for 19 years, again, you know, have lots of stories with lots of people. I don't know that anybody's mentioned John Hickenlooper, but hearing Rob talk and knowing how Rob, you know, loves the F-bomb and and we all love that. The other good story that I thought about was you know, and thinking about like where we've come from was in Milwaukee. I think it was Milwaukee. Bob, correct me if I'm wrong. John Hickenlooper was our keynote speaker. For that conference, you know, our governor of Colorado now. But at that point, you know, kind of what we did was, yeah, you want to be the keynote speaker? Great. We're ready to go. So I remember John standing outside of the keynote room about 5-10 minutes before the keynote was supposed to start, going, crap, I better write some notes down about what I'm going to talk about. he didn't really have much on what he was going to say, and I'm sure it came off really well. I do remember there were a lot of F-bombs in that speech, right? And that was, at that point, we were like, okay, note to self, we need to vet keynote speeches before they start. So that was kind of a funny one. And then, of course, you know, my favorite one is Atlanta in 1998, when my daughter was born at the conference. And 6 or 5.5 weeks early, and Bob was, of course, there to drive me to the hospital. And my husband talked to him on the phone and said, "Hey, if I can't get there, I want you in the delivery room." Bob was like, "What? What? No, no way!" my husband got there, and my daughter was born in at Emory University Hospital in Fulton County, Georgia, which was not our plan. We were, you know, looking forward to having our child born in Boulder, Colorado. But yeah. So anyway, a little Southern influence, which I always love. But anyway, it's
the grace of God.
I remember being at the Home Brewers Conference in Baltimore in some year with 95. With John Pinkerton and hanging out on the sub dudes bus and you know, it's been a lot of fun. It's been a lot of fun. There were a lot of cloves there, and like I said, it's been so much fun, and this is such a great group of people. So I feel very fortunate and very honored to be here, and as Sam pointed out, you know, we all, I think most all of us knew and loved very much Danny Williams. And he was a big part of the GABF and of the Brewers Association and of the World Beer Cup. And to know Danny was to love him. I never heard Danny say a bad word about anybody. And I guess before I tear up, just say, let's raise a toast to Danny. Here's to Danny. And good friends.
Just a 20-second story about Danny. My eldest daughter is now 18 years old, and we went to a party at Paul and Danny's house back then, up 4 Mile, snowed like a MF-er, and we had a daughter, and we had a sled, and they had a long driveway, and we dragged my daughter up on the sled. She was a couple months old, and there was a... You got up to the house, and there was a raging party going on. And we had a case of beer on the sled along with my daughter. And, that's a classic 1994 memory of what was going on.
You know, I mean, as Nancy mentioned, Nancy, Tom, and I have worked together since 1993. So we've seen a lot. And... I've got, you know, so many memories. One of the things that Nancy just said about Danny that really strikes me is how Danny never had a bad word to say about anybody, and that's so true. But that makes me think about, you know, our founder and Charlie, who never, ever has a bad word to say about anyone. So, here's to you for that. I know I would not be as gracious as he is. So. Different styles, right? But, no, I've got, you know, a few different memories I want to talk about. The merger, I was there from both sides. You know, and I was there when Kim joined the AOB board. And certainly there was a lot of angst and trepidation about the merger. And, you know, 2003 and 2004 when that was coming down. And many of you, you know, are familiar with Slow Food USA. And at one point on the AOB board, we had the executive director of Slow Food USA, a guy named Patrick Martin, on our board. And that was due to Charlie's connection with Slow Food. And I can remember Kim's first board meeting with the AOB. And she comes in, and we knew, you know, everyone there was like, you know, Kim's going to have an agenda. She wants to promote the merger. And Kim gives a very eloquent speech and talks about, you know, one trade association, we all need to be together, and very, you know, succinct, well done. And I can remember Patrick turning to her and saying, "Excuse me, who are you?" And I was like, "Oh my God!" So you handled it very well. So, but you know, that was a seminal moment for me. Another one was, you know, I grew up in the Mid-Atlantic area, right outside of Baltimore, and we had a family reunion, 1996, 1997, in Rehoboth Beach. And I can remember telling all my family, "Oh, we're going to go to this great place, Dogfish Head Brewing Company. It's a brew pub." And they're like, "Okay." And I take my whole family there. And we go in there, and we sit down and order beers. And there was not one beer in there that any one of my family members could drink. They were like, "Dude, you need a new job. You are..." And fast forward now, I can't even get them to drink 60 minutes. It's like 90 minutes is the only thing they want to have. And so, and then, you know, the last thing I want to say is just, you know, I look around the room and, you know, the Association of Brewers, now we're the Brewers Association, but, you know, I look at, you know, my colleagues, Nancy, Tom, Stephanie, and Paul. You know, certainly Barbara and Tim, Cindy as well, but you know, the people were there that, you know, that we've worked so long and so hard, you know, and here's to you.
I know a lot of this is supposed to be about history, but I want to put a little asterisk mark that I just had a 6-year-old Dogfish Head stout with bacon ice cream, with candied dates, and whatever else was in that dessert. It was absolutely amazing, and these were things we never would have enjoyed 10, 15 years ago. But I also want to kind of enforce and bring up my quiet half, who supports me on the SDHAGC side, Chris Graham. You know, one thing I like to say is I'm the only non-commercial interest on the board. I am the bullshit detector. I'm the canary in the coal mine. And Chris is in the business of beer, beer, and more beer, but it really is a homebrew business, and it represents thousands of homebrewers. Actually has more customers than we have members. So get up here and say a few words.
All right. So Gary changed my mind on the story I wanted to tell today. I'm a quiet geek. As if you don't know this already, I don't say much. I just think a lot, write a lot. And So I got into this homebrewing thing when I was in college. I was like, oh, that seems pretty fun. And it bit me. And I'll get to that in a minute, because that's what connects me, I think, to all of you. And that's what I love about this industry. But so here we are. We're a bunch of geeks, and we have a homebrew shop, and we're doing stuff other people don't seem to want to do. We're welding and having some fun. So we hear this magazine. We call it Zymergy because we don't know how to say it. And, you know, we're reading some books. We're having fun. We're like, oh, we got to advertise in that Zymergy thing. So I called Julia back there. And I came from the biking industry, and so that's my first memory of the AOB at the time. And I'm like, Julia, I want to put in a two-page spread right in the centerfold. How much? And she's like, I don't know. So she gets back to me, and she's so excited about it. I'm like, something seems wrong. But hey, why not? So we do this, and it's the most god-awful ad. I'm colorblind. I should never be allowed to make ads. But long story short, I'm like, I like these people. I can connect with them. But I think they're this huge, monster, well-run, perfectly organized group. And my band of misfits, called Beer, Beer, and More Beer, we just kind of barely squeak by with numbers like Tom's talking about. You know, huge debt and a little bit of money and a lot of credit cards. And so we keep going, and finally I get to go to my first homebrewers conference, which was in Dallas. And Gary comes out in a, do you remember what you were wearing, Gary? Cowboy outfit. And I was just like, I really like these dudes. I can connect to this. So apparently there's a picture up in Aaron's office of both of them out there. And so I'm like, I can really connect to them. We were the only ones, I guess, who asked to be a booth there. Was that right? So they stuck us in a hallway. We were in the hallway between seminar rooms, and we're like, yeah, this is great. Thus, Club Night was born. And so we just kind of got to grow with the AHA, and then what I considered the AHA, I know it's the AOB, and then the AHA behind it. And then I got just blessed and lucky enough to sit in a table with all my idols. You guys are all right here, and I'm just like, I didn't know what to say. It's, you know, Jesus Christ, don't say anything stupid. That's about the only thing I could think to say. And then, so time goes by, another homebrewers conference, and I have to kick Ray Daniels out of my bed because I want to go to bed. He's passed out now. Different story. We could tell that a different night. So, long story short, I got to say one thing to one person who's changed my life, changed my business, and is Bob Pease. He may not know this, but More Beer was the biggest band of misfits. We couldn't pay an invoice to goddamn save our life. And I met this guy at the BA, and I'm sitting at these meetings, and like, God, this guy's got his act together, and he seems like he's really driven, and he's hardcore about, like, this is the task, and we're going to do the task. And I'm like, I need someone like that to do my finances. So I hired your imitator. His name's Dan. He saved my life, saved my company, and thank you.
More beer than our best customers.
I'm Steve Broad. Bob has brought up, I think, a favorite catchphrase of, or statement of his over the years a number of times since I've known him, which is that, you know, sometimes it's better to keep your mouth shut and let people guess whether you know what you're talking about than to open it and remove all doubt. It took me years to figure out how that worked. Some might question whether I've figured it out yet, especially by the time I get done with this. But, you know, I my introduction into the whole AOB cum BA thing was I was an official pain in the ass. Staff, I think, will remember this well. If Sharon Mowry was still around here, she'd be like, oh, God, that guy was... just that would have been, you know, early 90s. Well, or early mid 90s. Oh, I started on Sharon early. No, don't worry. No, you weren't the first. And you know, I kind of kept poking at this thing, and you know, it was the we talked earlier in the meeting today about, you know, needing to appreciate. Kim talked about needing to appreciate the certain level of naivete of some of our membership, and I think I really came to appreciate that this year when I was walking through GABF as chair of the events committee, even though everybody here knows that that doesn't mean anything because Nancy does everything. The membership, you know, kind of goes, oh, well, okay, I can bitch to him. And getting these guys coming up and going, well, and you ought to do that. And, you know, and you ought to. I was just like, wow, okay. I'll have a sense of humor about this because I used to be that guy. I was that guy for a long time. And as this whole thing transpired, you know, some of the first people that got up talked about their, you know, their early moments were going to those BAA meetings and being kind of intimidated by all these people that they were with that they'd kind of seen and heard about but hadn't really interacted with. You know, through this sort of odd, circuitous route, I ended up on the AOB's Board of Advisors, and then they sent two of us up to be on the Board of Directors, which happened to be just starting into the process of the merger, and I'm sure that, you know, I'm sure Charlie saw me get appointed to that group and went, oh, shit, what's this guy going to say? And I got in there, and it was sort of one of those moments of, you know, Steve, it might be time to just shut your mouth for a while and listen to what all these people have to say, because you're way, way out of your league here. And saw a bunch of people come from two very different directions and try to combine two organizations into one that was actually going to work, from two that either one of them on their own were probably about ready to die. And I learned a tremendous amount. I think the things that didn't happen that a lot of people thought were going to happen say as much as the things that did. The AHA did not get thrown under the bus. The GABF is still alive and happening. The resources of this organization have come together into something that's really quite phenomenal, not just sort of frittered away. And I think, you know, the last lesson that I drew from this was seeing not only my attitude change, but seeing how people grew with the jobs they took on through this organization. Charlie, you talked earlier today about Larry Bell's career with the AOB and the Board of Directors, and how Larry, you know, I do love a flamethrower because I was there, went from somebody that was really tossing the grenades to somebody that embraced what was going on and put his all and his energy into making things work. And seeing the skills that each different chairman of this organization has put in, since Kim with her very sort of painterly approach that you could see all the brush marks and all the strokes, and she made clear how this was all going to work, and everybody, you know, we're going to work this way, and it'll all come together into a pretty picture. And she got about halfway there, and then her time was up. And, you know, Steve Hindy with a little bit more maybe analytical approach to it, trying to get things, yeah, you know, we'll pull a little of this here, a little of that there.
I'll take that comment.
Yeah. And then, you know, Rich Doyle, who we all kind of thought, oh, wow, man, the bull in the china shop is marching in, and came in with tremendous energy, tremendous sort of fear factor for a lot of things, and turned out to do a tremendously responsive and responsible job of approaching this. Getting to work with Nick Matt, the senior statesman, who always sat through those meetings early on that I'd, you know, everybody just go, Nick's so quiet. And Nick would sit there quietly and look, and then all of a sudden Nick would come out with like three sentences, and it would completely sum up everything that everybody had been trying to say in paragraphs for hours, and like three sentences, and Nick's like, got it, and we're all, okay. And I'm really looking forward. Sam, you did a fantastic job today. You're off to a great start. It's been a pretty big education for me over the years, and I'm enjoying continuing it. So,
thank you
all.
I'll talk. I'm John Mallett, and I'll talk for a minute.
So, when I started thinking a little bit about this piece to talk to, you know, really great group, I thought about structure, and I thought about stature. And, you know, like, what a great structure to be in, and what a great group to talk to. You know, the AOB, the BA, the BAA. I mean, I just have, I'm just in awe. So, I think about brewing in terms of a marriage of art and science, and I'm so much more comfortable with the science piece of it, because the science piece is really defined. There are structures, there are enzymes, there are pieces that I just get, and there's another part that I'm not that smart about. So, one of my earliest experiences with this organization, and I'll talk about this organization as AOB, is that when I was in Washington, D.C., working with Old Dominion back then, Charlie came by and saw us. And I was just in awe because this is like early 90s. And I had been through Siebel and I had gotten the science part, but before that I had homebrewed and I had, you know, complete joy. And here was Charlie, and he came to see, you know, he came to see us, and he came, and it was like, wow, you know, here's this guy. And the part that was the amazing part was just this engaged discussion with Charlie, and he says, you know, you should really be talking to the larger organization. And you hooked me up with Virginia Thomas, and I really felt like there was a part there that where there was an asking for voice. There was an asking for an engagement. There was an asking for to fit in to a larger structure, to see yourselves as part of this larger framework. And the discussions that then started were just amazing. In that, hey, we should have a bigger technical piece. We don't have a technical piece. And, you know, I remember Virginia bringing me out here to Boulder to start the technical program with John Harris. And the two of us sat in a room with Virginia and talked about how we engage the membership at this very nascent stage and to start to provide technical skills. And I just felt like that was so cool to have a voice. I clearly was not going to go to AB. I was not going to go to ABI. And I developed such a strong relationship with John Harris and to sort of start to build this sense of a technical track or a technical piece through the AOB and through the CBC. And that really, for me, came to a head when I was standing at an MBAA conference with Harris. And we're, of course, in like some vendor suite. It was probably Briggs. They used to have this awesome Weissbier thing, and they'd hand everybody glasses. And, it was late at night. And talking to these people from ABI, or AB at the time, and them saying, like, you know, like, there were technical people who you read about in magazines, and saying, you guys actually have pieces that we don't have. You guys actually know what the hell you're talking about. There's something that adds there. And I feel like that the AOB, the BA, has provided the structure, the underlying piece there, that has allowed us to attain a stature that's just incredible, that's was unthinkable in those times. I go back and I think about the scientific piece. You know, the parts that I'm trained in involve like enzymes. And enzymes are, you know, they're biological catalysts. They're pieces that if you throw stuff into a solution, they floats around. These random pieces float around and maybe they line up. But if there's a catalyst, if there's an enzyme, the enzyme takes this and this and lines it up and puts it together and you have a greater whole. And to me, that's the piece that this organization has consistently done for this industry. And I am just so incredibly thankful to be involved with such great folks who have done this consistently for such a long time. I mean, it's really, I can't tell you the incredible pride I feel to be involved with all of you, everybody here. I mean, it's just really, it's very close. So.
Wait.
After a beer break,
because
they're weird.
Are we close?
I'll be quick. I got childcare. I gotta get home.
All right, we're doing. Julia's up, and then we'll do a beer break.
Waiting.
Is it Jordan?
I'm good. Okay, I might be the last. More of you can speak. My name is Julia Herz. I'm proud to be the craft beer program director of this fine association, and how convenient. We want every restaurant in this country to have a craft beer program. That's a beautiful thing. I stand here after story and realize I'm a product of all of these years and of all of the marketing and of all of the effort. My 1993 story is being at a beer festival in Colorado, and I won a membership to the AHA, and Charlie was at that beer festival, and it really changed my course. And after that, I started volunteering at the Great American Beer Festival, where Paul also started. So, you know, on the staff level, I represent about 40 of us that each have our journey, that have taken the piece of the brewer side and executed what you all have had the vision to bring us to. And it's, you know, it's a powerful thing to be a part of. I would say that, you know, we have to, I think, maybe bringing it to the future, because we've talked a lot about the past and how we got here. I mean, we have issues right now and challenges of beer snobbery and maybe closed-mindedness and getting too complex as a beverage. And what I'm so reminded of in this room is the fun behind craft beer. That's what it's all about. And we powerfully, on a day-to-day basis, have to emanate that message that we don't want to do what wine did. Wine boxed itself into a corner with snobbery, too high of a price point, pairing into very closed little corners of the world. And that's a challenge that we continually, on a day-to-day basis, try to take the history that you've built in this room and, you know, bring us to 2015, 2020. And I'm very excited to hear what you all have discussed today and tomorrow on where we will go in a visionary sense, because staff needs that direction to emanate what you as members will want to see us execute on your behalf. And I, you know, I'm a walking soundbite, I admit it.
I'm voting for Julia.
Well, I thank you. But I'll throw two out and then we'll wrap it up. But I call it trickle-up economics. And what to me this entire movement is, that I am honored to, you know, follow John Mallett in his impassioned speech, you know, and my course has been changed. All of our courses have been changed, but it's trickle-up economics. And we have taken an industry that was run by giants and given it a small business success story in the United States spin. And that is an incredibly powerful thing. That doesn't happen every day in every industry. And that trickle-up economics needs to continue and shall continue with the direction and the symbiotic relationship of member to staff direction. I mean, I really feel that. I remember Chris brings up the ad, and I did sales before I did this, and then I had 5-year hiatus. I'm a boomeranger, and I birthed 2 children in that 5 years and then came back at the Brewers Association. But when I was around my first tour of duty selling ads for our publications, which was really hard to do, I said to Steve Parks, who was doing American Brewers Guild, you know, he needed a tagline. I'm like, why don't you just tell people to live the dream? And you know what? I can't go and wear any, if I wear any brewery anything on my person that's brewery related, or read a magazine, on a bus, on a plane, on a train, people stop me and want to get into this very industry that you all have grown and nurtured, and that we have as staff have a responsibility to grow from there. So, you know, live in the dream. There's not one day that goes by that I don't remind myself of that honor, that we are living the dream and other people want to get into this dream. So how do we direct them as they get into this dream to carry it on in a proper manner that doesn't just make it a business but continues it on as a community? And so there you have it. Thank you.